All right, I want to welcome everyone to our March 28th Planning Commission meeting. If you would all please rise and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, I'm sitting in tonight for the chairman, so if I'm a little rusty, you'll please excuse me for that. Our agenda tonight consists of the consent agenda, which is the minutes from our March 14th meeting. Then we have two public hearings that we will hear together, as they both are concerning Colonial Highlands. One is a rezoning and one is a planned development concept plan. Then we will also include in that the preliminary plat for Colonial Highlands, and then we will have a master alternative sign plan for Alliance Financial and Income Tax. That being said, I'd like to start with the consent agenda.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Peel.
I move that the minutes from the March 14th be approved as submitted.
I have a motion.
Second.
And I have a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes have been approved, and I would like to briefly remind everyone of our procedures for a public hearing. We will open the public hearing and call for exhibits from the city attorney. Then we'll have staff comments, and the applicant will make their presentation. Then I will ask for witnesses in favor of the petition. And I would like you to raise your hand if you'd like to be recognized. You can come either to the center or over to the side, whichever is more convenient for you. State your name and be sworn in before you begin, please. And we would like, if you're speaking for a group, let us know that. If you are sharing the same opinion that others have, you know, raise your hand when you hear someone. I'd rather not have any kind of vocal or comments or anything like that. Then I will ask for witnesses opposed to the petition. Then I'll bring it back up here for general discussion. Then I will close the public hearing and we will discuss and take a vote. We will have two public hearings combined, like I said, the rezoning on Colonial Highlands and the planned unit development concept plan on Colonial Highlands. I open the public hearing and ask for exhibits from the attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the public hearing rezoning RZ02165203, the city has 8 exhibits. Those exhibits are Exhibit 1, staff report with attachments, Exhibit 2, affidavit of publication in the Examiner on February 27, 2016, Exhibit 3 is the application with its attachments, Exhibit 4 is the 185-foot notification map. Exhibit 5 is a list of names and addresses of owners within the 185 feet of the site. Exhibit 6 is a copy of a letter sent to the property owners. Exhibit 7 is Title IV Land Use Section, Blue Springs Code of Ordinances by reference. And Exhibit 8 is the 2014 Comprehensive Plan by reference. Those are the exhibits for RZ02165203. For the public hearing plan development concept plan, PDC02165204, the city has the following exhibits. Exhibit 1, the staff report with attachments. Exhibit 2, the affidavit of publication in the Examiner on February 27, 2016. Exhibit 3 is the application with its attachments. Exhibit 4 is a 185-foot notification map. Exhibit 5 is a list of the names and addresses of property owners within 185 feet of the site. Exhibit 6 is a copy of the letter sent to the property owners. Exhibit 7 is Title IV, Land Use Section, Blue Springs Code of Ordinances by reference. And Exhibit 8 is the 2014 Comprehensive Plan by reference. Those are the city's exhibits for the second public hearing.
Thank you. Mr. Wright.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Before you are three requests related to the Colonial Highlands development, which is proposed north of Southeast Wyatt Road, west of Southeast Adams Ferry Parkway, and generally south of Southeast Major Road, which is a future road that's proposed. Total development includes approximately 62.65 acres. The first request is for a rezoning from SF7 PRO, which is Single Family Planned Residential Overlay, to SF7 Single Family and TF2 Family. Approximately 48.78 acres will be zoned SF7, which will be primarily on the west and north side of the site. And then 13.87 acres will be two-family zoning down here in the southeast corner of the site. The comprehensive plan and the South 1 specific area plan, which includes all development in Blue Springs south of Moreland School Road and west of Adams Dairy Parkway and Shroud Road, designates the property as mixed-density residential, a mixed-density neighborhood, which includes a range of housing types, including single-family homes and small-scale multifamily. Per the comprehensive plan, multifamily is appropriate on transitional blocks between neighborhoods, corridors, and centers. At this location, the two-family zoning district is placed appropriately as it creates a buffer along Southeast Wyatt Road, which is classified as a major collector, and also as it creates a buffer along the east property line adjacent to the commercial property that's Colonial Nursery. The proposed rezoning meets the intentions of the comprehensive plan and the specific area plan, and therefore staff does recommend approval of the rezoning request. The next request is for a PD plan development concept plan, again for the same 62.65 acre site. The concept plan does include 115 single family lots and then 33 duplexes for 66 units total with the duplexes for a total of 181 new dwelling units. The first phase of development will be in the southwestern portion of the development with access from Southeast Wyatt Road. Southeast Major Road will be constructed as part of phases two and phases three when the adjacent lots are developed. Both Southeast Wyatt Road and Southeast Major Road will be classified as collector streets and will be improved or developed as such, which will include a 60-foot right-of-way and sidewalks on both sides of the street where applicable. Two stormwater retention areas are proposed for the site. There will be a wet bottom detention area in the southwest corner of the site, and then a dry detention basin here in the northeast corner of the site, which is the only part of the site that goes north of Southeast Major Road. The site has required a minimum of 6.96 acres of open space. The site has provided 7.74 acres, which includes trails and two pocket parks. The trails will make a connection to Adams Dairy Parkway Trail, which will run along the south side of Southeast Major Road, and that'll be developed in lieu of a sidewalk. So instead of a 5-foot sidewalk, there will be an 8-foot hike bike trail, similar to what's already existing on Adams Dairy Parkway. And then here where the roundabout is, there will be a spur off of that trail that will come through the development and then down into the community amenities area down here with a trail that will connect hopefully to future developments to the south in the Chapman Farms area. The largest pocket park, which is Tract J here, will include a community pool and cabana as well as a playground. In addition to these open space systems, there are numerous other areas that will be kept as green space and other spaces where the community can have recreation. There will be green space, smaller pocket parks that don't meet our requirements for the open space system, but still do provide open space in little courtyards and the duplexes, and then also some of the islands that have been created along some of the streets. The average, with 181 dwelling units, the average density is 2.89 units per acre. For comparison, this is slightly denser than the single-family Parkway Estates, which is 2.7 units per acre, and much less dense than Eagles Ridge with 3.78 units per acre. Proposed floor area classifications for lots 1 through 68, which is this northeastern part of the development, will be classified as Class G, which requires 1,400 square foot homes, and then lot 69 through 115, which is this western part of the single family homes, will be Class F, which is 1,600 square foot homes. No minimums are required for duplex units, but preliminary floor plans generally range between 1,050 square feet up to 1,450 square feet. The concept plan does allow the applicant to request modifications to the underlying zoning regulations, a list of which have been provided on page 8 of the staff report. I'll go through just a few of them. The applicant is requesting to both reduce and increase lot widths to allow for a greater range of lot shapes and sizes. Minimum setbacks are requested to be reduced for lots 1 through 68, which is again is this northeastern part of the development, from 25 foot to 12 feet for corner sides, and then 8 feet to 5 feet for sides. Front and rear setbacks will remain at 25 feet and 15 feet respectively. Most duplex lots, which are required to be between 80 and 100 feet, will be wider than the 100-foot maximum to accommodate some of the curved streets here, as well as to accommodate side entry garages. Angled on-street parking will also be permitted here in front of the community pool with a development and maintenance agreement for public works requirements. Proposed preliminary building elevations. These are some preliminary floor plans that they have provided. And then the preliminary elevations for the duplexes that have been provided. This is an example of a duplex that will have one unit with a front-loaded garage and then a side-loaded garage on the side. This is a duplex that will have an alley-loaded garage, so both units have garages on the rear of the home. And then this is the front of the recessed garage home. So one of the requirements is that the garages must be recessed 12 feet further back from the front building line. And then we will also be with a final plan. These will be more detailed plans, and they'll be reviewed per the multifamily or residential design standards. A preliminary landscape plan has also been included here, and then again another final landscape plan will be submitted with the final plan to ensure that all landscaping requirements are met. In addition to that, they've also identified some identity markers such as monument signs that will be placed along entrances. Those will also be reviewed with the final plan. Staff does believe the proposed concept plan meets the intent of the comprehensive plan and the UDC. Proposed modifications to the zoning regulations will improve the quality of the development, and staff therefore does recommend approval of the concept plan with the 12 conditions in the staff report. And the final request related to Colonial Highlands is a preliminary plat, which I've pretty much gone over almost everything involved with that with the concept plan, so I won't go into too much detail. Just a few other items that were included with that is that trail sections, such as along Southeast Major Road, where they are not within the right-of-way, do require a pedestrian access easement to allow access and maintenance of those that trail. 15-foot landscape buffers shall be provided on the front of each lot to accommodate street trees. A landscape buffer along Southeast Wyatt. It was shown on here as 40 feet, but that was an error. It would be between 20 and 25 feet, as the landscape buffer or the alley cannot be included with that landscape buffer. So the area between the right-of-way and the alley will be, that'll be the landscape buffer. Easements and best management practices are required for all stormwater detention and features. and access easements are required over all private streets and alleys for access. Drafts of the Declaration of Restrictions and the Homes Association Declaration have been provided, and staff does recommend approval of the preliminary plat with 12 conditions. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have on any three of these items.
Thank you, Mr. Wright. Do we have any questions for staff?
Go ahead, Jason.
Mr. Sanders.
Can you tell me how many lots we're talking about? I can't really tell.
How many lots? There's 115 single-family lots. There will be 33 duplex lots. Each duplex will be on its own individual lot. And then there are 13 tracts, which will have the common open space.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Peel?
Mr. Wright, and I'll look to guidance from council on this, but one of the documents that's in the three applications is not dated, nor does it declare whether Mr. Salih has any interest in, as a partner, major stockholder, or things like that. So I would, since these will be public record, I probably need guidance from you.
With the time it goes to council, it will have to indicate that, and if someone had testified today as part of the public hearing, that would take care of it for this meeting.
Okay, do we have somebody that's representing Mr. Salih? Would you be, can we use him as a witness to the document being needs to be signed?
Well, someone will need to testify at this proceeding that he has authorized this and that he's an owner. And I think we verify with the legal description also the ownership.
Okay.
So they can do that when they come up to testify.
Okay. Thank you. No further questions, Mr. Wright?
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Wright.
All right, thank you.
Would the applicant like to come forward and get sworn in and make a presentation?
Turn your right hand, please. You solemnly swear the testimony about to give this case, give the truth, self
guarantee. Yep.
Please make a grace.
My name is Tyler Salih with Salih Homes and Colonial Highlands Development, 3730 Northeast Troon Drive, Lee Summit, Missouri. With me tonight is our engineering team from Schlegel and Associates, Greg Musil from Doffitt Fretz Law Firm, and Wayne Kirkhoff, WLK Design, who is our land planner who's been working on this project with us. And I'm actually going to hand it over to Wayne to answer any questions or present what we have here tonight.
You want to tell me you own?
Yes, I am part owner of Salih Homes, the applicant, and am representing Randy Salih tonight.
Thank you. And you'll need to be sworn in also.
All right. Okay.
Yes, I do.
My name is Wayne Kirkhoff, WLK Urban Design, 11437 Flint, Overland Park, Kansas. We've been working on this with the city staff for several months, and I have to say that I would compliment staff on how well they worked and communicated with us, and we've walked through the new UDC, and I think we've either satisfied or gone beyond any or most of any of the requirements in the UDC. The development was originally platted and some existing sewer lines were installed. So part of the layout is based on some of the sewer lines that were there that we didn't want to move. However, the original layout was all one type of housing and more of a grid street pattern. This layout has more of a diverse kind of housing product and curvilinear streets. The entrances are set up to slow traffic calming, where the entrances off of major road are T T-intersections or the roundabout that would slow traffic as they enter, and then the one entrance off of Wyatt has the open space on one side, and then it gets to a turn that goes into the Parrott Homes as well as the amenity. So we wouldn't have driveways and cars backing in and out of entrances as people enter, and that was important. I think Matt's explained the different areas of zoning and building types pretty well. What we've tried to do then is set up common open space areas as well as landscape buffers that would be usable for everyone, including an open space trail connection that would go from Major Road down to Wyatt. Let's try to summarize this, I think. And basically, I think I've got everything that Matt talked about and that I want to say, just that it's a development that would accommodate different housing types, and we paid a lot of attention, especially on the Parrott Homes, to how the garages are handled, either side entry or front entry, but none with both, with the exception of the recessed garages, and then there's rear-loaded garages, so we've got the rear lanes for that. I might go through a few. Matt went through these elevations, so I don't know that I need to. And floor plans, those are in the packet. These are some of the homes that are at Parkway Estates. So we'd be using the same kind of housing product there. Some of these pictures are a little bigger. So they have 2 and 3 car garages, and all the single family would be for sale lots, whereas the Parrott Homes, in some cases, I think they may be sold. However, Salee Homes would retain ownership, and some of them may also be leased. They would all of that area would be maintenance provided, however, so all the landscape and everything would be under a common association, and the Salee would maintain it. I think that's about all I want to say right now. If there's an opportunity or any questions afterwards, we'd like the opportunity to come back and answer any of those questions, but I'll go ahead and turn it back over to staff.
Do we have any questions for the applicant? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak in favor of this petition? Is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak against the petition? Yes, here in the front. You'll come forward and be sworn in? Yes.
I do. My name is Mark Hatfield, 28904 East Wyatt Road, Green Valley, Missouri. And I do not live within 185 feet, but I'm about a half mile down the road, so I'm speaking on behalf of a lot of the closer neighbors down the street. I think they asked me to talk. I have an interest in the way Blue Springs grows. I've lived on Wyatt Road for 33 years. I graduated from Blue Springs. Is that not on?
It is, but you'll just need to come up closer to it.
Get closer. Okay. Is that better?
No. He's saying.
No, back.
He's saying back away. You're too.
Oh, back away. Got it.
Okay.
Anyway, I have an interest in the way Blue Springs does grow. I graduated high school here. My parents graduated high school here. My grandparents moved here in 1936. And I've seen Blue Springs go from almost nothing to what it is today. And the neighbors along Wyatt Road, we all moved out there to get kind of a more rural lifestyle, and we realized that town is growing out towards us. And when it got annexed a few years ago, it was annexed as single-family homes, and the city assured us that it would probably stay as a single-family home annexed area, and that's the way we would like to keep it. So our main concern is with the multifamily home part of this development. One of my neighbors supplied me with an article out of the Blue Springs Journal, which is dated Saturday, April 5th, 2008, which addressed some of the planning issues of Blue Springs. There was a survey. The Kansas City Star did a citizen satisfaction survey, and there was 19 cities surveyed, and Blue Springs finished 17th out of 19 of the 19 cities, which the city council said at the time was unacceptable. They said if it weren't for our park system, we would have finished 19th out of 19. And a couple of the key areas that I'm going to point out in the article stated that, and this is a quote from this article, which I have a copy of, if any of you would like
that. We'll need to have you give a copy of that to the attorney for an exhibit.
Okay, I have a copy. Would she like it right now?
Before you sit down.
Okay, thank you. It said that Blue Springs was the lowest rated suburb in the metro area and the city's response to growth, city planning, and development. And the rating was a reflection of what they said Blue Springs is building, which is multifamily housing, and the blight on our retail corridors. It also mentioned that building permits are 2-to-1 for multifamily to single-family housing since the year 2000. And it says that many citizens feel this area of housing is putting a drain on our school system, which I agree with. I taught school for 30 years. So did my wife. And we've seen the drain on the school systems and the traffic, et cetera, that uncontrolled growth can burden us with. And it also mentioned that renters do not pay the same tax rates that homeowners pay. I'm not real familiar with that, but I'm just reading from the article right now. Our mayor, Carson Ross, agreed, saying that the single most important issue facing Blue Springs is, quote, too much multifamily housing and not enough starter and dream homes. And he mentioned the traffic was another issue. So, in closing, I think we all realize that growth is going to happen, and we would like a controlled, planned growth that's good for the city. And our issue is with the multifamily units in this addition, and we just wanted that addressed. So, are there any questions?
Are there any questions? No. Sorry, these mics are a little extra sensitive. Are there any questions for this witness? I would like to ask Mr. Holly if you can help me with this. The statement that he made about when this land was annexed being zoned single family, I don't recall that. When we annexed it, there wouldn't have been any zoning actually set in place at that time.
No, I don't think there was, but I would have to go back and see if with the annexation there was a rezoning of the property at the same time. There may have been. I just don't off the top of my head know if it was rezoned at that time.
And I know there, correct me, please. There was multifamily in the annexation plan that was done for the South region when it was done.
Yes, there was.
So it was not blanket, the whole south region would all be single-family or anything like that?
No, it was not. And a good example of that is Chapman Farms, which was highly mixed-density type of development when it came into the city. It was planned that way.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, just for the record, I've marked that article as Exhibit 9 for both public hearings.
All right, thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak in opposition? Yes, please come forward. Be sworn in.
Forgive me if my voice is a little... Is this okay?
Yeah.
You're good.
Yes, I do. Okay. My name is Linda Redwine. I live at 27307 East Wyatt Road, Blue Springs. And I am Linda Redwine, and I've lived on 18 acres on Wyatt Road for 40 years in a house over 100 years old. More than half my life has been spent restoring, remodeling, and investing in landscaping, raising children, Arabian horses, and show dogs. This property is my life's investment. We're still suffering the damage from the last developer who walked away, leaving only his destructive footprints. And you were talking about the single family zoning. I think if you'll look back, it was when Mr. Tharp was going to develop that property. And he built a silt pond, a retention pond, which looks like it was exactly where this one is gonna go. And that pond has seriously damaged our pond from this poorly constructed retention pond. My neighbor's backyard cannot be mowed and has not been mowed in 8 years because they left piles of dirt and it becomes a bog during heavy rain. I have letters from DNR stating the violations. Our pond is actually acting as a filter, which prevents the Sniabar from being contaminated. It doesn't seem legal to me that a developer can be allowed to destroy private property on the other side of the road. And Blue Springs nor the developer were willing to do anything about correcting it. I understand that there is serious damage being done now to private property caused by the Salee development along Adams Dairy and Moreland School to Taylor Road. I just hope we are not to expect more. When the massive annexation occurred, it was zoned for single family housing. I recall that. I live there. I, for one, was comfortable with this new administration was put in place to enhance and improve Blue Springs. Some good things have taken place, but the multifamily and rental situation has continued to downgrade with each new proposal. Now we have a new developer and a new proposal asking for rezoning with higher density and more multifamily and rentals. Our neighborhood's not against development. We welcome more neighbors and new neighbors. We hoped our city planners would plan our neighborhoods more responsibly and show respect for the integrity of the longtime residents south of town. We don't need more cookie cutter houses all neatly lined up in a row and more rentals. The character of our neighborhood will be lost forever. Blue Springs had a golden opportunity to develop the rural area with single family homes, nice single units, owner occupied with similar pride in their property, larger yards for kids to play and dogs to romp. An area that would encourage people with higher incomes to move to Blue Springs and people who already live here to upgrade without having to leave Blue Springs. It's heartbreaking to drive around town and see the many multifamily units built in our city. We're fast becoming the rental hub of the metro area, if we aren't already. My family and I left the Grandview area in 1976 to raise our children in a safer and more respectable neighborhood. Blue Springs has become an embarrassment. This proposed rezoning is simply not in harmony with the existing small farms. Rental duplexes will certainly reduce the value of our property. High density is just not acceptable. We were very concerned about traffic, which is already a serious problem. We've had at least one serious accident. Our 30-mile-per-hour street has become a 50 or 60-mile-per-hour drag strip. Dogs get killed, and no way could they stop for a child. That'll only get worse. Never mind the deer being chased out of their habitat and causing automobile accidents. Livestock is also a big concern. We have horses and donkeys and farm animals who will police our fence lines, our ponds, our equipment sheds, all attractive to children. We can put up electric fences to protect our livestock. We can put purple paint, no fishing signs on our ponds, but none of these measures will protect us from the lawsuits when somebody climbs the fence and gets kicked or bitten by a horse or drowns in our pond. We are aware that we cannot stop development and are not trying to prevent Mr. Salih from making his fortune. We only hope that our city planners will adhere to the original zoning plans. Please don't drive out your old residents who supported Blue Springs for many years. We've enjoyed beautiful farmland, rolling pastures, gorgeous sunsets for many years. We understand that part of our lives is threatened, but you could at least preserve the property of the few people left who would like to remain here in peace and safety with their livestock on their small farms. Many residents seem to have a larger vision for Blue Springs. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any questions for this witness?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Peel.
Ms. Redwine?
Yes.
Since there is development, obviously, that's going to happen. Since there is development happening in the south portion of the city, is your basic concern just multifamily?
Yes.
Or what would you really like to
see? And rentals. Everywhere you drive in Blue Springs, there are rentals. Everywhere.
So you wouldn't be against like regular development, right?
I would not be against single family homes, reasonable lots, reasonable size homes. We don't need any more little cracker boxes. We've got those.
Understood. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have a question? Okay, thank you. Would the applicant like to make a comment in response?
I think our goals are real similar, that we are also trying to accommodate new housing as well as empty nester kind of housing with the paired homes. And I hesitate to call it multifamily because that to me means apartments, and these are two bedroom, two bathroom homes with attached garages in all cases. And what helps when we can cluster these homes together, we can get the common open space that gives us the opportunity to have a common themed landscape grounds throughout. So there is some benefit in not having individual lots in the common open space. Then allows us to put all these trees and maintain all this open space as one. So, and the buffers exceed any of the requirements that the city has in their new UDC. So we have made efforts, and we've actually changed the plan more than once to accommodate the UDC. So I think we feel like we've got a pretty nice plan, and that it shouldn't be the impact to the neighbors that it could be if it wasn't so well thought out. The improvements to the stormwater area, I think Mark can get into that if that's necessary, but that should help alleviate any concerns that are existing now. So that'll all be cleaned up and redone and developed with a water feature at the main entrance. So I think all of this is going to be improvement to what's out there right now. The existing nursery just to the east of the property. It was also, one thought was that that would be a good place then to put the attached housing next to that as sort of a transition into that commercial area. But I think we've tried to lay it out with the inside layout of the development in mind, as well as the how it affects the external. We haven't put a lot of entrances and extra traffic that could be detrimental. So,
are there any follow-up questions? Yes, Mr. Sanders.
I think the question probably that the audience has is, why not all single family? I think that's the ultimate question here. And other than common space, I haven't yet heard that argument.
It helps get the cost down so that it is affordable for entry level as well as empty nester product. And so there is difficult, and the costs I think are still over 200,000 if any of these are for sale, but it just helps.
Okay, you've got to be quiet. We've got very sensitive mics, and everything, every time somebody's mumbling back there, it's coming across all over the place. So, and I will give you another chance here. I'm not done. I haven't closed the public hearing yet. So,
single family and the paired homes help with the transition from the commercial area as well as the streets. And it does allow us to have these common buffer open spaces that will help separate it from the surrounding area.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Have you done any study or given in-depth thought as to the effects of the multifamily on the future value, even of the new single family being built in the same vicinity?
We haven't studied financially, I guess, what the cost, but we have blended it in to where there's a separation with the open space corridor that's coming down from Major Road to Wyatt with the trail in it, and I don't see that it's a detriment.
I would like to comment on that.
You're still under oaths from earlier, so.
I'm still good?
You're still good.
Okay. We obviously have an interest in this entire project, both on the paired housing and the single family, and it's our goal to not do anything that'd be detrimental to the single family portion of this project, because again, we do have an interest in the entire project. So our goal here in the paired housing is to offer a different use, a different style of product. If you'll look at some of our renderings that we've presented here tonight, they're quite a bit different than what's been done in Blue Springs in the past. We've met all the requirements of the new UDC code with some of the setbacks that are required, the garages being around to the back of the home, side of the homes. We've based a lot of this off of a similar project that we've done up at Shoal Creek Parkway and 435. Very similar product. We hope similar clientele, similar tenants, where we provide all the maintenance for the community. We provide all the maintenance of the grounds, snow removal, etc. That we can offer someone more of a carefree living within our own community. Our hopes are those people become buyers in our community, move into some section of the community, whether it's the section up to the northeast, or even the other single family lots, the larger lots on the west and north. That's our hopes, is that we can have people that are moving up in our own community. Again, we've seen some of this in other projects that we've done around town. We've seen it in projects that we've done here right within the city. For instance, that's been brought up tonight, the Parkway Estates project up at Moreland School Road and Adams Dairy. So again, we're trying to feed off of some of that we've done. We have goals of building very similar product to what's at that neighborhood in that community. We want everyone in the neighborhood to have a common interest. Everyone will have access to the amenity package, whether you live in the single family portion, the paired housing. So again, our intentions are for this to be a positive to the neighborhood, especially to the development, as Wayne said, internally and externally. So I'd be happy to answer any other questions.
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Duvon.
I have two more quick questions.
Sure.
If I can. First one being, do you have an idea as far as a rental amount, what range you'll be renting these properties in?
Based off of the other project that we're doing that I mentioned up north, if we were to sell one of the units, a half a unit up there, our price ranges are in the 220 to 240 range per side. Our rental rates are in the 1800 to 2000 range.
Okay. And I know you've talked about the numbers here, but without looking back at them, do you know off the top of your head what the ratio of the duplexes or paired housing, whatever you're calling them, to the single family is?
What the ratio of?
Like how many units of the multiple versus the single family?
What we have proposed here is about a third, two-thirds single family, one-third of the paired housing.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I would say that the paired homes, if you actually would scale the distance they are from Wyatt Road, most of those are 60 to 70 feet or more away from the right-of-way line to Wyatt Road. So there's a significant separation between the buildings and the Wyatt right-of-way.
Was there anyone else who wanted to speak against this proposition?
I have a couple of questions.
If you'd like to come forward and be sworn in, you're welcome to ask them.
Okay.
That's what we're here for.
Okay.
My name is Patricia Koppel. My address is 7721 South Sunfield Road, Green Valley. We are east of this development on the other side of Cook Road, just off of Major. And I have a couple of questions. Is this portion of Major Road scheduled to be put in with the rest of the development? The piece of Major Road from Adams Dairy to, I don't know, does it go to Seven Highway? I'm a little confused as to exactly where this piece of Adams Dairy or Major Road goes to and from.
Eventually, Major Road will go from Seven Highway to Adams Dairy Parkway, but with this particular development, the developer, in fact, is required to put in half road improvements along the frontage of the homes. Ben, maybe you can speak to the oftentimes the city will work with the developer to have them build the entire road section between point A and point B, and then when the development of the north side of Major Road occurs, they would complete the development from point B to point C. That makes sense.
Not exactly. I'm not understanding what you mean by half development.
The requirement within the UDC is that they build the road adjacent to their development, which would be half street improvements. So the south side of Major Road, mm-hmm. the owners of that property would develop half of the road, and then the owners on the north side of Major Road would develop the north half. rather than have a half road improvement, oftentimes the city will have one developer do full road improvements for half the length of the roadway. And that way you don't end up with half road improvements.
Okay.
Now, whether we're doing that or not, I can let Ben address.
So basically, the developer might have to develop the road, major road from Adamsbury Parkway to about halfway in between the two entrances.
So,
and then the developer who develops on the south side would develop the other part of major road.
Or on the north side.
On the north.
This,
on the north
this
side,
is,
I'm sorry. Yes,
yeah.
On the north side.
Okay. Okay. So your access into this property then would be either off of Wyatt or the one entrance that would be covered by the development of
As it's phased in, yes.
Okay.
The future portion of Major Road 27 Highway will be developed whenever Eagles Ridge and Timothy Lutheran complete their developments, and they'll make that connection, so Major Road will connect from Adamsbury 27 Highway.
Okay. Because I was a little unclear on that. And my other question that I... As you were speaking of keeping the multifamily housing as a buffer along the west side to, you know, to provide a buffer there, then what about on the north side? Because that's single family housing there adjoining the commercial property on the north, where on the west side it's multifamily adjoining commercial property. You understand what I'm saying? If it's important to have it on one side, why not the other? Or
whenever we were laying out this project initially, as Wayne spoke, there was some work that underground work utilities that had already been done in the project, and we kind of had a target number. I guess we didn't want more than about a third of the project to be the paired housing like we have shown here. We understand that the single family lots that are backing to the commercial on the north side of the commercial, the south side of our project, those might be less desirable to some people. To some people they might be more desirable not having a neighbor directly behind you. So it was just kind of a stopping point for us whenever we got to this design. And again, it was something that kind of that laid out well with what was already there from where we started.
And what school district would this area feed into?
This is Wyatt Road is the boundary. So north of Wyatt is Blue Springs, south of Wyatt is Lee
Summit. This would probably all feed into probably Cordell Mason.
I don't know what the boundaries are for each individual school.
That would be the closest Blue Springs school, and I think looking at the huge expansion Cordell put together to accommodate the massive multifamily housing apartments there behind Walgreens on 7 at Moreland School Road, I'm questioning, you know, how is the school district going to be able to handle a large influx once again?
Because I wouldn't want to speak for the school district, but the school district does have some other land on the south side where there is a possibility of another elementary school. So,
I'm just asking once again, I'm coming from a somewhat of an education point of view, and when you're looking at large amounts of multifamily housing, you're going to probably see a lot of new attendees in the school. So that's all.
Are there any questions for this witness? Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak on this petition?
Do you solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give in this case would be the truth, so help you God?
I do. I'm Linda Dugan. I live at 27800 East Wyatt Road. I'm surrounded by Colonial Nursery on three sides, on the corner lot of Adamsbury and Wyatt Road. And I have a few questions. One, what is the difference between the purple and the rust color? Because those look bigger.
We have three different types that we've proposed, and the different colors or shades just indicate whether it's which style it is that we've proposed. So we have one style where we have one front-loading garage, one side-loading garage. We have one style where it's both front-loading but has a recessed garage. And then we have type three where it actually has alleyways and rear-loading garages. I think Matt addressed in his presentation that ranging from square footages of about 1,100 to 1,500 in square feet. So we have a little bit of a variety of sizes as well.
Okay, so they're all duplexes? They're not fourplexes? The purple
all,
are?
All duplex, correct.
Okay. And then I know that there's an issue. I'm married to a retired firefighter, so there's an issue with the housing development that went in on Blue Springs, Adams Dairy, Parkway, just past 40, north of 40. Can't think of that. It may be called Adams Dairy. But it's a lot of the duplexes, but the fire department, CJC, has issues with getting in and out of there. I know there's limited number of parking spaces because the lots are so short. I think guests can have only two cars, things like that. So, because that looks really congested to me, and I'm not seeing the open space really that you're talking about. So I'm concerned with being a resident on Wyatt Road. Where is all the parking gonna be when these people have guests over? Is CJC, are we running into the same issue that, I don't know if you guys are aware that, but if one of those catches on fire, they're gonna have a hard time fighting that.
CJC,
that complex there, so.
CJC does have to sign off. They have to look at all these plans.
Yeah, and actually the duplex portion of this development is in Prairie Township.
Okay, that's a bigger problem.
That's not a problem we can address tonight.
Right. We have looked at that, and we've communicated with Prairie Township, and the street that all these are facing will meet the standard residential street requirements, and the rear alleys, their requirement is a minimum of a 20-foot drive for access purposes.
Okay, so there's roads in front of and behind each one of those duplexes.
For the rear-loaded garages, there are, and that's mostly the units on the southeast corner of the duplex area. There are alleys behind those.
Okay. And then back to the road question. So since one developer has to build, is responsible for one half, and the developer on the other is responsible for the other, it looks to me like the only entrance that's going to be working when this goes up is the one on Wyatt Road. Is that correct?
In the first stage of development, that would be correct.
That our proposal is phase one starts at Wyatt Road. That's entrance number one. Phases two and three would be to the north and to the east. And the way we've designed this is our main entrance off of Major Road is actually the second entrance, the one furthest to the west. And our plan is to construct Major Road to that entrance to give us a third access to the community.
On phase two or three?
Phase two or three. They, like Jim said, we're responsible for building about 50% of that road. That entrance is about 60 to 65% of that road.
Okay, so phase one is the colored portion.
No, phase one incorporates some of the colored phase, and then also some of the single family lots. The entrance comes off of Wyatt Road down at the southwest corner.
Okay, so phase one is all color and a portion of the black and white. Is that right?
Phase one probably stops where track J, where the road in the.
I believe in the map on the first page, it does show the phasing there, and they had 23 single family lots and 18 duplexes in the first phase. So they're going to complete about half of them with the first phase, and then the second phase would be the remaining duplexes. So they wouldn't all be developed at one time.
That dashed line over here on this exhibit on the left is essentially everything to the south and west. There would be phase one, As you can see, it's spelled out there, phase two and then phase three.
Okay, so you'll develop the duplexes, a portion of the duplexes, and then the single family up through phase one before phase two. Is the
That's how
idea.
We have it proposed now, yeah.
And
you can see a little bit easier on this exhibit. In the southeast corner, the dark line that goes back behind those units is the other road that accesses the rear-loaded garages. It's a little bit harder to see on the other.
Okay, so between phase one and two, it's very possible that the only way in and out is Wyatt Road. Because we don't know when the major road's coming in. Am I correct?
We will be responsible for major road as a developer. We will be responsible for building major road.
Okay. We're still looking at 60, about 85 residences through that one entrance up over Wyatt Road, or what's that number? Do you know?
Phase one, 23 single family lots, I believe, and 16 or 18 paired homes.
Okay, so
that'll enter Wyatt Road.
If you'll give me the total of phase one and phase two of how many residents that is.
That would build major road for phase two.
Yeah, for phase two, we'll have to build major road to it, to enter it. We'll have to have.
So it's not phase two or three, it's now phase two that it will be built?
Yes, to enter into phase two, we'll have to build major road.
Okay, because you said phase two or three, but now it will be phase two?
If we construct, yes, when we construct phase two, we'll have to build major road to enter.
Oh, once it's constructed, then you'll add phase two.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so again, we have about 100 families or whatever that number is coming off Wyatt Road. Okay. Well, I think it's obvious to say that I have a real concern with that much traffic in that one area. Again, I think our biggest concern is the multifamily and rental property. I mean, everybody up here, I'm sure, would rather not have rental neighbors than family-owned homes. So I think that's all the questions I had.
All right, thank you. Are there any questions?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Peel?
Mr. Slee, would you have designed the multifamily or parent homes had the Colonial Nursery not been on that side, on the east side? Would you have made that all single family?
No, our intention from the beginning was to have the parent homes included.
Okay, because eventually Colonial Nursery will probably close and that land will become available. So if it fits with what will go, you know, what development will happen in that area, but that's to be down the road. But anyway, I just kind of was interested whether you designed that from the get-go. Thank you.
On some of these questions on the parking, guest parking, I would say that all of the homes have an attached garage. They all have parking in front of the garage door, and they would all have on-street parking for guests, especially those with rear-loaded garages. There would be no driveways cutting out into the street, so any guest parking could be there. I would also say that we could have lined up the paired homes along Wyatt, but we chose to lay that out with more of an undulating pattern, and that'll allow us to do some creative grading and berming and landscape buffering that should really set that apart from Wyatt Road. And once those trees grow up, it'll be separated visually completely. So we do have an opportunity with that space to do something pretty nice.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman, I have a question for staff.
All right.
Notification letters, were there any received on any of the three applications?
No, none returned.
Okay, thank you.
All right. If there are no further comments, I will close, or I will bring it back up here for discussion on the record. I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, you may come up and have to be sworn in.
Do you solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give in this case to be the truth, self you got?
I do.
Is your name and address?
My name is David Redwine. I think the neighbors have pretty much given you what our impression is of the development and all the multifamily around.
I'm sorry. We need your address also.
I'm sorry?
We need your address. We need your address.
27307 East Wyatt.
Thank you.
I may be a little premature in this, but it's something that needs to get on everybody's mind. The previous developer or potential developer for this area, it did not go through. But my situation is the retention pond that you have to move that up a little bit so we can see it. This so-called existing retention pond that's there, at the time that was dug without prior planning or permit at the time. And it was brought to the city council's attention, and they went through and tried to, after the fact, permit it, and there was still no study done on it. But with all these houses, there's a lot of square footage of rooftops, paved roads, paved driveways. It has a lot of rainwater runoff, and has a study been made about this runoff, where it's going and how it's released onto other people's property? And of course, mainly I'm concerned about my property and the pond that we built. And I have some pictures here. I'll submit them. This is what the pond looked like before the previous developer went in and, like I say, without permit or without study, dug this so-called retention pond. After rain, this is what it looked like going into my pond. They asked them to do some work temporarily. And as you can imagine, this is what they did, which was next to nothing. I've already lost 20 feet of the entrance area to my pond on account of silt runoff of this thing. So my concern is if there's a proper study done on the runoff, how that water will be released from the development onto our property. Will the volume of runoff stay the same as it would be natural without this development? And the quality of the water runoff after it's built, so that my pond and my acreage is not destroyed. So anyway, I just wanted to bring that to attention for thought, so that if this development goes through the way it's planned, or if it's changed or whatever, my concern personally is the retention pond, the amount of water runoff, how it's released, and the quality that it's released onto other people's property and how it affects us.
I can let staff address this more completely, but by code, the development cannot increase the runoff from what it was prior.
I understand that.
So the runoff has to remain the same.
Well, I understand
there
that.
There are studies that are that have to be done.
But it was not done prior on the previous developer, and that's my concern. We know what is supposed to be.
And
what we want is the end result.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got to protect my property.
I understand.
Would you like to see these pictures?
Yeah, you'll have to bring those up for the attorney to be entered in as an exhibit. Would staff like to comment?
Excuse me. No, I noticed that the developer has put up their preliminary stormwater management plan, a cover sheet, and I would just as soon allow them to address their stormwater management plan. If staff has any comments at all, I would hand that to our city engineer.
I'm comfortable with having the developer's engineer go over his study that he submitted.
You'll need to be sworn in.
Before we did it, I could just
make
a record on the exhibits. Exhibit 10, or I'm sorry, 9 will be, I'm sorry, 10. We have a lot of exhibits. Will be the before photo of the pond. Exhibit 11 will be the after photo of the pond after the detention was dug. Exhibit 12 will be a photograph of the attempt to handle the silt at that detention facility. The next exhibit will be the no silt fences after heavy rain for the pond. And then the last exhibit will be the neighbor's yard, which cannot be mowed. And I will number those and render those into evidence.
All right, thank you.
Commissioner.
Yes, Mr.
I have a question.
Mr.
The gentleman who just spoke. Is this the first time that you have brought this to the attention to the city? Have you mentioned this to anybody before?
No.
You don't.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, we've got to have you on the recorded record.
Go ahead. We did take it to the attention of the city many times over.
Yeah. We fought this pretty hard many times over during the period of time of the previous developer. And quite frankly, nothing ever came from it. That's my concern now, because we went to many meetings. We had people from soil conservation out, and they wrote up reports, and we walked the property with them, and they cited all the violations. I'm sure it's still in the city records from the previous developer that the retention pond that he dug was without permit and without study. And we brought that to the city council's attention many times. And then finally, I don't know what happened with him, but that project went by the wayside. And you have the picture evidence right now as to, you know, what the effect is. And like I say, I've already lost 20 feet of my pond already from the silt runoff. And when there's a rain, it just comes flooding down through there. And yes, by code, there should be no more volume runoff than is normal. We know that. But as for it actually happening, we need to have an assurance. We need to have a study done. The effect of the rooftops, the paving, the driveways, and everything, how much volume of water we're talking about, so that if there is a retention pond there, it can be done properly and only release the quality of water and the quantity of water that should come off of that property that will affect our property.
And I believe that's what he wants to address right
yeah.
now.
Okay.
Can I just make a statement?
You've had your chance. I don't want this thing to drag on for hours. I'm sorry. I don't want to keep repeating things.
But it's your property.
Well, I've been sworn in,
and I'm right. The driveway into his project will match my driveway.
Okay.
We did go to DNR.
Okay, we've got that on the record already.
Okay, I didn't know he said DNR.
Yes, we've had that on the record.
Sorry.
Would you like to go ahead?
Do you solemnly swear the testimony about giving this case to the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so you got it?
I do. My name is Mark Brewer with Schlegel & Associates, 14920 West 107th in Lenexa. We work closely with city staff on this. They made us aware pretty early on that there was that the existing basin was improperly constructed and that there were some downstream drainage issues. And so that was one of our key points in completing the final design. So with this project, we'll be reconstructing the outlet works from that existing basin and reshaping that basin to provide additional detention volume. On this release point here, it may be difficult to see exactly, but area we're talking about is RP1 here, this release point one. The existing, and we were required to provide detention for the 1 year, 10 year, 50 year, and 100 year event. So the 1 year is the more frequent event, and the 100 year obviously is the flooding event that everybody's familiar with FEMA floodplains and stuff of that nature. But for example, on that specific release point, the existing release rate is 221 CFS, and our proposed release rate is about 84 CFS, or about 40% of what the existing release rate is. So I think we've done a good job of over-detaining, if you will, to really be sensitive to those downstream issues at the direction of city staff. And in addition to just the stormwater detention aspect, the city also has a water quality ordinance. And so this basin here will function as an extended wet detention basin with four bays, native plantings that is intended to enhance the water quality, filter sediment, uptake nutrients to help improve the water quality leaving the site. So I think those were kind of our goals starting out, and I think the plan we presented does a pretty good job of keeping with those goals.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Peel.
Mr. Brewer, would you explain the dotted lines to me? I have not seen this drawing.
Yeah, these represent watershed boundaries, so each one of these is kind of the way to graphically show how much drainage area goes to a particular point. So that's our existing, and this is our proposed, so.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Brewer.
All right, thank you. Okay, are there any more comments up here for the record?
I have.
Mr. Peel?
Mr. Chairman, I have a question for staff. I think that's already been answered, but thank you.
All right.
It just popped in my head, so I thought I'd ask.
All right. Then I will close the public hearing. And we will bring it up here for more comments and or motions. The first item we will be addressing is the rezoning RZ 216-5203.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Peel.
In respect to the people that have shown intent against the development, because of multifamily, I understand your concerns, and I know the destruction of property is really a big concern, obviously, to everyone, not just you, but for people that eventually will move into that area. But in respect to the city and the development and the comprehensive plan that's been in place, I would like to move that RZ 216-5203 for Colonial Highlands rezoning be approved.
Do I have a motion? Do I have a second?
What was the motion again?
The motion was to approve the rezoning.
Approve for rezoning. A second.
And I have a second for Mr. Haney. Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Planning Commissioner Kratoff?
Aye.
Commissioner Sanders?
Nay.
Commissioner Haney?
Aye.
Commissioner Peel?
Aye.
Commissioner Bartolotta?
Aye.
Commissioner Duhon?
Aye.
Chairman Billups?
Aye. Okay, we will recommend approval of this measure to the City Council, and they will be hearing this item
April 4th.
On April 4th, and theirs is also a public hearing, I believe?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And then we will move on to the plan development concept plan, PDC 216-5204.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Peel.
Also, with the understanding from the witnesses that have spoke, I would make a motion that the plan development concept plan PDC 0216-5204 be approved.
With the 12 conditions?
With the 12 conditions, yes, sir.
Have a motion?
Second.
A second from Ms. Duhon. Can we have a roll call vote on this also?
Yes. Planning Commissioner Sanders?
Nay.
Commissioner Haney?
Aye.
Commissioner Peel?
Aye.
Commissioner Bartolotta?
Aye.
Commissioner Duhon?
Aye.
Commissioner Kratoff?
Aye.
Chairman Billups?
Aye. Another one. And then we also recommend approval of this to the City Council. Thank you all for your comments. And we'll now move on to item number 4, which was the preliminary plat. And we have already heard all of this as well, so we're just looking for discussion and or motion on that.
Mr. Chairman, if there's no further
Mr. Peel,
discussion.
I don't believe there is.
Yeah, I move that preliminary plat PP 02-16-5205 be approved, and I believe there are conditions on this as well.
12 also.
Yes, 12.
I have a motion.
Second.
From Ms. Duhon, a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
And that motion carries, and the preliminary plat has been approved. We'll now move to item number 5, which is the master alternative sign plan for Alliance Financial and Income Tax. Would the staff like to make their presentation, please?
Chairman and Commissioners, we'll be looking at, if I can scroll down for it. Oh, is this one of those? Okay. Okay, here we go. We'll be looking at Alliance Financial's request through Gator Graphics with Dean Will. Their request for a monument sign along Vesper Road, or Vesper Street, sorry. It's approximately 650 feet west of the intersection of Vesper and 7 Highway. And it's located at 807 Northwest Vesper Street. And here's an aerial for the location of this. It's approximately a quarter of an acre, zone general business, and it currently has offices in the building, in the existing building. The only, the main issue with this is the location of the where they want the sign. The lot is relatively small. It's the building is set back quite a ways from the road. If I can find the, there it is. Building set back quite a ways from the road. To the east of them is a building that's brought up closer to the road. So their visibility is taken away by that existing building. And their usage of wall signage is compromised because of that, I guess. So with that, they're requesting to have a monument sign closer to the road than is typically allowed. They're requesting a sign to be 5 feet and 6 inches away from the property line when it's normally only allowed to be 10 feet from the setback from the property line for a monument sign. This is a picture of their proposed sign. And this is the location of the sign in relation to the property line. They're working with a few existing conditions. The existing parking lot comes up actually closer than the 5 foot, or closer than where the sign will be. So they'll actually have to take a little bit of their existing parking lot away to fit this monument sign in its location that they're proposing. With that, two things I guess that the staff had concerns with was the proposed stone facade on the sign. We would rather see that be matching the existing brick building rather than the limestone that they're proposing. The other issue is with the setback, as I mentioned. With that, staff recommends the approval of this master alternative sign plan with two conditions of the brick must match, or the stone must match the brick building, and that they must obtain all proper sign permits. If there are any questions.
Are there any questions for staff? Regarding the base of the sign, The existing building, is it just like a concrete block? I mean, it's just a block building. It's not any kind of, or is it brick?
It's brick front facade at the very least, a reddish-white brick mixture that was probably built in the 70s, maybe, I'm guessing. So we'd recommend that it's at least a reddish brick material that the base is made out of as well to match the existing facade.
Because I kind of like the limestone. It looks very nice. It dresses it up a little bit. So do we always require the sign base to match the building, or is this something?
It's one of the design requirements of freestanding signs and most signs in general, that it complements the building. It doesn't necessarily have to match exactly, but as long as it complements the building, then that's...
How far is the sign from the building? What's the distance between?
Oh, let's see if I
can... I have my glasses on.
This is approximately 57 feet from the property line to the front facade of the building. Minus the 5 foot setback, approximately in about 5 foot, so about 47 feet approximately.
Quite a distance.
I agree. I like the building the way it is myself.
Any other questions or comments for staff? Okay. Thank you. The applicant like to make a presentation. Is the applicant here?
I don't believe so.
Was he here? We lost him or in the public hearing?
I don't know if he was here. He did get noticed.
From my last understanding on Thursday, he was going to make it, but...
Is he aware of your request to change the base of the sign, and does he have an opinion, or has he stated an opinion to you about that?
The Gator Graphics, Dean, the guy, the applicant, I have mentioned that to him, and he said that he will make it work with the applicant, and he doesn't have a preference either way. The applicant, I do not, or the property owner, sorry, I do not know whether or not he has a preference, but the sign company didn't speak for him, I guess.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Peel.
I would like to query the panel. Is there anybody else that would have additional questions on the sign? reason being is that if there are further questions, I would also, I may move for a continuance till the next Planning Commission meeting.
It would not be without precedent that we have done that when the applicant is not here to answer a question.
And that's just it. Does anybody else have any questions that they want to ask the applicant?
You can make a motion and we can decide whether or not that is, whether we need to hear the applicant or not.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move that alternate sign plan ASP 0316-5228 be continued to the next Planning Commission meeting.
Second.
I have a motion and a second from Ms. Duhon. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? No. Motion carries, and that item will be continued to our next Planning Commission meeting. Please request the applicant to be here. All right, we'll move on to other business. I believe everyone has in front of them a save the date page for a workshop on current legal issues on planning and zoning that will be held on April 20th, downtown Kansas City, 600 Broadway with Mark. Are there any other announcements? What do you need to make reservations from us? What kind of time frame are we on?
April 15th is when reservations need to be in. So,
Mr. Chairman, I would like to mention that this particular training opportunity came about almost the same time as our Eastern Jackson County Planning Commissioner training. And so the three cities, Lee Summit, Independence, and Blue Springs, all agreed that in lieu of that Eastern Jackson County Planning Commissioner training, that this would be a great opportunity to bring the commissioners in for this particular training. So, and just to let you know, it is in lieu of that. And if you're interested,
so
please let Karen know.
We'll be doing this instead of?
That is correct.
Okay.
That is correct.
So preferably by the 13th. Okay. Yes, Mr. Peel?
No, Shane, you can put me down.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, any other announcements? Nothing else, I would entertain a motion to be adjourned.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Peel?
I move that the Planning Commission meeting be adjourned at this time.
Thank you. Any seconds?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.